All right, we can finally proceed to what you have been eagerly waiting for. I would like to take the opportunity to introduce the man who needs no introduction whatsoever. Mr. Pavan Kalyan. Mr. Pavan Kalyan, who has lovingly been given the title of Power Star by all you fans, is truly the king of Tollywood. But behind the stardom lies a very simple and humble human being who's driven more to serving people and society than to celebrate box office records. Mr. Kalyan, who has an incredible following amongst the youth, prefers to be seen as one amongst the common man than as a privileged star of society. It is this philosophy of his, the Pavanism, as it is known, that is the core value of his party, Jansena. He truly is the most powerful common man. Through his political career and with the support of his fans and party supporters, who are presumably his soldiers in arm, he hopes to do good for the people of his state. And that is perhaps what makes him a true power star. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Mr. Pavan Kalyan.
చేతిలో దీపం లేదు కానీ గుండె నిండా ధైర్యం ఉంది. నేను ఈ రోజున రాష్ట్ర ప్రభుత్వాలు కానీ కేంద్ర ప్రభుత్వాలు కానీ అడిగేది, ఒక క్రానిక్ గా ఒక ప్రాంతం వేలాది మంది దశాబ్దాలుగా చనిపోతున్నప్పుడు ఇది ఏ ఒక్క ప్రజాప్రతినిధి దృష్టికి ఎందుకు వెళ్లలేదు?
After some time, there was an old lady who was like blinded from her childhood. She was a 60-year-old. And first time till then, I never knew people without eyeballs actually making drive. It never came to my experience and not science student to understand. First time that the lady was trying, I said, guys, I don't know what you're going to do, but we need just water. They're requesting for to have a basic water, nothing else. We don't want anything. We need drinking water. To get the drinking water, we have to go all the way to a few kilometers away. We struggle. Could you get us water? That deeply pain. But, like, I heard about it. I went back to another constituency. And they put it just a few kilometers away. I'm talking about from that place is the next meeting I read was of 60 kilometers away. And they put this kind of mineral water bottle in front of me. And I felt so guilty. Then that lacking of water, here I get a mineral water, I found it. Like a criminal. And after somehow I lost interest in the political process, I only told my friends and someone who was following me, I said, can we do something? We don't know whether we're going to win or not, but at least can we do something about it? And luckily, if you can stay forward and some who could identify the water bodies on the ground, they were there. And within no time, they could dig a hole in the next 1 week, they had a drinking water there. What I'm trying to tell you is, if I, as an individual, if I could do that much, can you imagine the power of machinery? Can you imagine the power of government? What they would keep, what they're capable of doing? Then I said, what made them not to go ahead and do it? Because nobody, it's not that I'm saying the entire political class is like that, but majority, they don't want to make it first. For them, what is the next move? What is the next way to earn, to get benefits? It is like the apple-polishing attitude of a political class is really denying the development of the underprivileged. And this is what really pains me. And if you ask me, like, to talk about how the global emergence of, like, how India can raise the global power, I don't have the enough experience. And there are enough experts, there are enough intelligent intellectuals out there who have a better idea about it. What I can say is that I can speak on behalf of common men because I've been there, I lived there, and I come from a lower middle class background. And finally became an actor. I would like to address these issues. So that I know the pain of each one. And we talk about women empowerment. For me, there are a few key issues which I would like to bring to your notice today. One is about the women empowerment. There is heavy budget for everyone and everything. And women empowerment, in our schools, there is no personal hygiene for growing girls. And they have enough money, and somehow does not reach it. That's the problem. And today we want women are the biggest force. We want to empower women. And first of all, you have to give them a healthy lifestyle. Even the so-called social welfare hospitals are there, and they are heavily being neglected. And these are the issues which are burning issues. And also, the major problem in India is the women's safety. The women's safety is such a big concern. And what Gandhi says, in the middle of the day, a woman could really walk, that would be the right, that's where we had achieved the freedoms. But in reality, even in daytime, if someone has to go, that's quite a risky situations are there, even in my own hidden thing, what they go through. So for me, what I wanted to do is, these situations are there, even in my own hidden thing, what they go through. So for me, what I wanted to do is, first of all, we should have a great, very powerful, the law and order situation should be there. Law and order should be really controlled and have a great say in safeguarding women. To get one Nirbhaya Act, when I say it is passing this, which really pulls back India. To get one Nirbhaya Act, because right from my childhood, I have seen the group, my sisters and aunts, I know that how they used to suffer. They never used to feel safe to go on the roads. To get one Nirbhaya Act, it took government for 60 years plus. That too has to happen in Delhi. Unless it happens in Delhi, we don't wait. Everything cannot happen in Delhi to make them understand. They have to feel the country, they have to feel the pulse of the country, they have to feel the pulse of people, which is missing. And recently I was talking about the, for example, the state has been divided, and we come from Indian Andhra Pradesh, but the state has been divided. What they did was, right from 69 to 72, both the states were to get separated. This is an example. On the basis of the complacent attitude of our political class, it took them. From 1670, both states wanted to get separated. They wanted to have their independent state. But somehow the government, central government said, well, they made them to be together. After some time, they had their own problems. Different, because they could never, whatever they had promised to make it together, no one had fulfilled them. So what exactly happened? Within no time, by the time I was growing, they started making, imagine the same language. We speak the same language. We just the dialect is different. And they started and they lot of the problem is the whatever they have been promised, it was not fulfilled. Suddenly the anger was being shown on another region people, which is no fault of theirs. I don't belong to the generation. I don't know what exactly happened around 40 years back. It was not under control. But the ground. But I'm facing the problem today. Somehow, it is quite a painful reason why. We will say India has to be one. We should feel the oneness here. One way to say in India, the constitution says we should be together, we should be as one individual entity and force. But in reality, they keep on dividing. As long as the divisive politics and vote bank politics are there, these kind of issues keep arising, and India's progress will be constantly will be getting taking a back step. We go one step forward with this kind of divisive and vote bank politics, constantly constantly looking at people as a vote bank. For me, I know a lot of political leaders, they don't look at people as people. People are filled with emotions, people are filled with love, pain, people are filled with love. But what they look at them is, that's my vote bank. This particular class is my vote bank. The particular region is my vote bank. They don't see them as humans. In politics, we should get a human angle. They are filled with emotion, they are filled with love and affection. We have to address that issue. Unless we address the individual as, we have to recognize as individuals, not as a whole pack. Till we do it, India is going to get affected by this kind of things. In politics, with this kind of whole pack politics. And after seeing this, because for me, the reason why I came into politics was I don't want another generation, the future generations has to suffer like me. I don't want them to suffer. I'm a little comfortable now. There's no need for me to come. But I said, for me, I felt like a service. I can't ignore. I'm thinking mine. I said, I feel painful. I feel extremely sad looking at the kind of a situation. Somehow, what best I can do? I don't have strength, and I don't belong to any huge political party, I'm not extremely rich. But I said, what best I can do within my means? Then I established the party, and I started highlighting each and every issue. Knowingly, getting into politics is like it's a path which cannot be won, and a destination which cannot reach. I know it, and still, I came into politics to serve a nation and to serve a people. When we talk about development, we should understand we have defined development. Development is for each individual means different. For me, a lady in Adilabad, her development is only a water every day. That's not development. For someone else, it is another kind of development. Maybe a housewife, it is nothing but to get her TV upright. And for a student, maybe a simple student, he needs a playground to play. This is what development means. Here we say that we, India is rising, India is achieving great standards, but the standards are not reaching to the majority of our Indians. And that's why you can see, even in Tamil Nadu, our other state, you have to understand why these large youthful protests are happening. Today we talk about the dividend, the great people of 19 to 20, demographic dividend. We want to reap the demographic dividend. But actually, in reality, what exactly are we doing for them? People don't do anything for them. They just plan. They keep on saying so many things. They keep on like, we're going to do for this, we're going to for youth. They announce a lot of measures, but actually, in reality, how much it is translating to whom it is reaching are two different things. That's why today, if you look at in Tamil Nadu, you better how many of you know about it. Lots of people came for Jalikattu, which is a traditional game of Tamils, to tame a bull. But the undercurrent reality which was there a few months before, they were saying that restlessness in our state, because the political situation is so volatile and no one is focusing on the ground, and it's very soon they want to rent out in a different form, we don't know in which form. And we could see that Jalikattu is, we should not see as a mere anger on taming the bull, you know, when the Supreme Court said against taming the bull. It's not just about that, it's their frustration. Mirror, you want to bring the democratic dividend, unless we identify them, we recognize them, and unless we challenge their energy, till now, India is going to give, India is going to see a rise of this kind of protest, including Andhra Pradesh, including Telangana, and including even recently I've seen in Gujarat. This is what is going to happen. This has to be addressed. And we talk about, and one more thing, we have to focus on education. And we look at most of the India is rural India and urban India. In other there are a lot of sectors. And if you look at each school, the urban schools, there is no one out there. There are no right playgrounds, there are no right facilities. Including when I was growing up, I never had a playground in my own school. I thought it was confined to my times or it was confined to them, but actually even if you look at it right now, all the urban areas doesn't have a playground. And here we want to reap the advantage of democratic dividend, and yet we can't even provide a basic playground to our own children. And not even state government or central government actually doesn't look at it. In which way, if we keep on ignoring all this, in which way we're going to reap the democratic dividend, in which way we can raise to reach that, how can we become a global power if we don't correct ourselves? My purpose is, not to undermine, but unless we highlight our issues, unless we highlight our flaws, what exactly happening, unless we correct them, it's going to be a very difficult challenge. What's happening in our country is, as progress, we take one step forward and we create a situation, we go back two steps. That's what is happening in our country. For example, demonetization. We are going at such a beautiful pace when the demonetization happens. What happened was, in my own 100 people died within our country. And all these people who died were nothing to do with the law, they were not corrupt, they were simple, middle class, hard working people, and they are the ones who died. And including in my own state, a man who they got to know their family, the old man went there, okay, I'm going to get some money from the banks, just staying in a queue for 2 days to get his money gone. To draw his money, to withdraw his money, waiting for so many hours, and he died of poverty. And these are the things which are actually hampering the growth of our nation. Because without doing the proper exercise, if you try to enforce this kind of laws, this kind of security, or this kind of law, the damage is going to be much more. And these are the things which all of us have to address. And today we talk about, you have to understand, the kind of political demonization actually is aimed for people, for black members. Who has the black one? It is not a normal, an average Indian citizen has black one. In which way they will get the money? It is found normally in irrigation projects. There are really big irrigation projects, and lakhs of crores, and thousands of crores, and very small project. But the money, the major money would be taken away from the project, it goes into the certain groups, certain people who are more closer to the political class, who are nearer to closer to governments, the money goes to them. And they are the ones who are spending the money. And imagine recently when there's a voluntary disclosure scheme in the central government of India now, and from their own state, the guy says, I have 10,000 crores to announce. You ask them, I said, from where did they get money from? It is a collection of, it is like he is a center point. He is just a faceless lot of political people who signed a lot of national wealth and kept with him, and they wanted to protect him as their man. Actually, the money belongs to a lot of politicians who have siphoned up money from the irrigation projects. And there is no check on that. And we can't enforce laws on them. The mass demonetization by doing it, who have got affected, the normal member, the real culprits, already they're free, they have nothing to do with them, they're happy on the roads. And nobody is going to do anything to them. And this is the plight of our country. And with all this, in which way, unless we correct all this, it is very difficult for us to go ahead and to become a global power. Unless we correct this, unless we correct the problems within our country, unless we punish the people who are the perpetrators and who are the ones who cycles of this national wealth, and it's going to be very difficult to reach the target of being a global power. And for me, the biggest thing in our country is the law is applied weakly to the strong and strongly to the weak. And in so many incidents are there, a person shoots and can get away. Imagine a simple guy, a normal guy, who comes. And even in the one way, without a helmet, he'll be punished so hard, but real people who has influence, who has the political affiliation, they shoot people and they get away in nominal punishments, and most of the cases won't even go to the courts. Somewhere they're confined to hospitals. That's it, they won't go beyond that. And this is what happens in our country. And people who cheat, rise, and they're completely having shoulder to shoulder with other big leaders. And in which way we can enforce? In which way we can control people? In which way we can make people listen? Because the top, who are the pyramid, the top of the pyramid, if they are themselves doing this case, in which way people are going to listen to them? And also the way people rule the national treasure, the way the people rule the wealth of the nation, including recently said, a few years back, if you look at in Bandari, there are a lot of mines who are supposed to pay a lot of taxes and extract the iron ore. What they did was, they take permission for persons, a small ore, a small mining area, and they're excavating the entire area without being paying taxes. The taxes that the pay, which is supposed to go to banks, which is supposed to go to government, and it is going to the pockets, and the developers here taking back step there. And those are the guys who are taking the shelter of politician. And unless we correct all this, India is going to get affected. It is going to be cooling down. It's going to be cooling down for a country which wants to emerge as a superpower. Unless we correct ourselves, these are the issues which have to be handled. And as I said, law and order is an issue. The biggest force in India is to promote tourism And there's a great possibility in our diversified cultures and vast kind of geographic advantage we have. We have the less tourist percentage. The reason being, one is, as a culture, though we can really welcome people to make them as stakeholders. The major problem is the safety. Unless we seek to give great security, a great safety for the tourists, as well, unless we strengthen the civil society, we can't be controlled, only police cannot do that. Unless the civil society gets strengthened, unless we make everyone as a stakeholder to give that kind of protection to the tourists in different aspects, and to make them as stakeholders, that will be a great advantage. And for me, if we want India to be really on top of the tourism, we have to enforce very stringent laws to safeguard women. And women's safety is a priority even for the tourists. Unless we feel that, unless we create that image out of India, Indian tourism will get affected. And Indian government and people and as a state government really should focus on the women's safety and also the safety of tourists who come to India, and that is going to be a great boost to our tourism.
Love you, Pawan Kalyan.
The democratic comrade.
See, for me, the youth leadership, today we want to talk about the demographic leadership. For me, what I'm doing is, every time every party looks at youth as part of the world bank. In reality, in India, youth means politicians and their families and their grandchildren and their grandchildren. There is no political. So for me, my biggest challenge, which I'm struggling, which I'm inspiring, which I'm making efforts, is how to build up that youth leadership. And if you have to understand, there is a great capacity in Indian youth. We not just mere see them as individuals, our workforce. They are the creative force of our country, they are the driving force of our country, and that's what the force has to be tapped unless we inspire them, unless we become the leading examples, unless we become the embodiment of what we believe in, they're not going to come forward. And for me, every party should look at youth as someone, as a creating force, not just as a one man. That's what I believe in, and that's what I'm starting up, that's what I'm trying to do in 2019 for Genesis. In spite of all these adverse conditions what we have, for me, always I believe in the saying that adversity limits the character. With all these challenges, I still believe if we become as one, we can be the global power, and whatever our intentions are, wherever we want to reach, we can be really the guiding force for this world. And then one major thing which I would like to say and I would like to close it is, so Telangana and Andhra, because I keep on referring to this issue on purpose, one of the senior political leaders said, though both the states were together as one unit, but as a culture they haven't merged. Enter India, though they say as one, still we don't have a cultural integrity, which is very essential. For me, I keep on addressing these issues from time to time. A guy in Bihar, a guy in UP, don't know much about southern part of India. They don't know much about Tamil Nadu, the leaders I'm talking about. And also at the same time, people from southern states, they don't have a great idea about what's happening here. This is the way, unless we integrate our cultures, we have a maximum of power to understand Germany, we have a maximum of power to understand France, We don't have any kind of cultural centers within our India to understand each other, which is the essential. This is really important. The reason is that re-emergence of identity politics is on the rise. This is going to impact the integrity of the nation. Unless our leaders and our political parties come together as one unit, unless they don't address this cultural differences in identity, and we slowly create a lot of problems. And that's the reason I want to take your notice as a culturally, somehow all of us should make an effort to understand each other, which is really needed to feel as one India and to make it to take it to at a global level. Being the kind of global power we are looking at, to become a global power, unless we feel as one, unless we culturally get as one unit, it would be very difficult to take it forward. And before finishing this, India is a massive society. Whatever happens, as I said recently, I was talking about a women's state that keeps saying in Bangalore, a woman was being molested in the middle of the road, and the omnibus were just looking at as if they are not a part of us. None has the guts, none has the courage, and none has any strength. One single guy was doing it. They could have thrashed it, but no one has the strength. Can you understand what is crippling our Indian society is the passions. How the passions has to be addressed unless we, our leaders, the problem is in assemblies, when the elected representatives watch pornography, when sessions were going on. So what kind of message people get? And this is what that's how it results in at a state level. For me, this is what we have to address the issue. Unless, for me, democracy is something all of us see very easy to comment. It's very easy to say this is wrong, it's not possible. Many people can comment, but how many people actually can come out of the doors and participate in the building of our democracy? How many people actually come physically? It's very easy. It's nice to be on the internet and on the Facebook to express your opinion. But in reality, if you come onto the roads, people are getting threatened, people are getting intimidated, and which has happened and which keeps happening. They keep threatening, they keep saying that you can, you feel like extra, you keep on expressing anything, and what are you going to bump you? I said, I'm fine. But I'm not going to stop whatever. There is a mistake of their society. They are forcing the society. If you want to bump me out, if you want to get in front, I'm ready for it. I'm ready for it.
No,
because this is the law of my nation, because I don't want the future generation to suffer unless someone within my capacity, what best I can do, I will do. So before finishing this, I'd like to say that to tell you the greatness of our country. And to feel what he is, because there's one of my favorite poets there in Telugu. His name is Seshendra, late Seshendra, he passed away in 2006. His books were shortlisted for a Nobel Prize. And I would like to say that first in Telugu. Pandavam Yapadiki, Uni Salam Chief. సముద్రం ఒక కాలంలో కూర్చొని ఉన్నారు. నేనంతా అక్కడికి మట్టే కావచ్చు కానీ నలభై దేశ జెండా But if I raise my voice, you will see the pride and strength in me of your nation's wife. Before finishing the service, India stands for Dharma, India stands for truth. We are the land of Himalayas and historical Vindhyas. We love everyone, but we fear none. We respect everyone, but we surrender to none. Thank you. Bharat Mata Ji.
You like this, Telugu?
Please. So we have about 15 minutes for Q&A.
Mike. Hello sir, my name is Rajani Kingley. You are my big inspiration. So I have a question here for you today. How can we contribute from our side to stop the farmers from coming inside?
Alright, we can finally proceed to what you have been eagerly waiting for. I would like to take the opportunity to introduce the man who needs no introduction whatsoever. Mr. Pavan Kalyan. Mr. Pavan Kalyan, who has lovingly been given the title of Power Star by all you fans, is truly the king of Tollywood. But behind the stardom lies a very simple and humble human being who's driven more to